Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Geology, a Very Short Introduction, by Jan Zalasiewicz, narrated by Eric Martin. Preface. This book is a sketch of an enormous, multifaceted subject, seen through the lens of my own lifelong journey through the subject, and of the enthusiasms that happened to develop along the way. And the nice thing about the subject is that few of its aspects did not become enthusiasms once encountered. I hope that it provides some kind of introduction to the spirit and the variety of geology. Chapter 1. What is geology? To do geology is a little like having the world's biggest and best time machine at one's disposal. The aspect of time is, of course, built in. We have, as our field of inquiry, as that notable geologist and paleontologist Richard Forty has said, the whole Earth and its 4.54 billion-year history, and everything that has formed on our planet over that enormous span of time. The early geologists of the 19th century were entranced and awed and mystified by the fossilized bones of monstrous creatures, unlike anything alive today, that they unearthed from sea cliffs and quarries. The sense of wonder has not diminished as our collections of dinosaurs and other extinct organisms have grown. Indeed, it has deepened as new discoveries have continued to be made of flying reptiles with 12-meter wingspans, of feathered dinosaurs, and of whole new families of fossil invertebrates. The level of detail that may survive underground through very many millions of years can be astounding, too, of not just bones and shells, but of skin, eyes, and feathers, of microscopic details of cellular tissues, and even of fragments of DNA. The ancient worlds inhabited by the dinosaurs and other long-vanished organisms are also part of geology. The swamplands and river floodplains on which the dinosaurs roamed can be as beautifully preserved as are their fossil remains. Those rock strata in which their bones are entombed are, in the most real sense, the physical remains of ancient landscapes from which a palpable sense of their environment can be gleaned, including some of the most subtle of events. Imprints of individual raindrops, the skittering of tiny insect legs, as well as the heavy tread of dinosaur feet, microscopic snowfalls of pollen grains, all of these can be imprinted into the rock surfaces. And because these are strata, and not just the surface of one rock layer, they represent countless landscapes building up on top of each other. The real geological record is that of a dynamic and evolving landscape, quite unlike the still-life tableau of old museum exhibitions. And, for the most part, these are mostly not landscapes, but rather submarine scapes, the physical remains of the bottom of the sea. They can faithfully preserve the evidence of phenomena that humans have never, even now, more than glimpsed, such as the traces of catastrophic sediment flows that transported many billions of tons of sediment for thousands of kilometers. It is geology and the rock record that make these processes, alien to land-living creatures, vividly apparent. Our time machine, though, does not just take us to long-vanished landscapes and ocean floors. Like one of the more outlandish science fiction machines, it can pass through the ground itself, taking us through into zones where strata are compressed by the enormous weight of sediment above and simmered by the heat of the earth below, so that oil and gas is wrung out of them. This underground journey can go further, passing through the roots of mountain belts where the rocks, squeezed by enormous tectonic forces and heated to near melting, are now unrecognizable from the fossil-rich strata they used to be. And where the rocks do melt, we can visit the magma chambers that form, and then stay with them as they slowly solidify, or follow those parts of the magma that race to the surface to erupt, where both the volcano's complex fractured interior, as well as its familiar surface topography, are within a geologist's gaze. The journey can plunge further down, all the way to the core of the Earth. The glimpses we have of this realm are shadowy and fitful, but they do reveal processes acting on a planetary scale, like the seismic images of tectonic plates slowly sinking into the depths of the Earth's mantle, or of rising plumes of mantle material thousands of kilometers high. Our geological time machine can cross dimensions in other ways, into realms where even science fiction writers rarely tread. Today, one can journey into the heart of a single tiny crystal that grew, say, inside a magma chamber, and examine the way it grew, layer by microscopic layer, in patterns that reflect the physical and chemical weather formed by the magma currents. Some individual highly resistant crystals, interrogated by carefully directed beams of electrons or ions, can show extraordinary stories of travel, erupted out onto the Earth's surface, where they may spend a few billion years resting in sedimentary layers before finding their way into another magma chamber to grow a little more, and then being released again to end their journey under a geologist's microscope. Some tiny crystals tell much larger stories. A few years ago, a tiny fragment of mineral found within a diamond was discovered to have formed in the crushing pressures some 500 kilometers down in the Earth's mantle, and survived the journey to the surface within its precious capsule. This mineral fragment revealed that the deep Earth contains, dissolved within it, at least an ocean's worth of water. This kind of science is high adventure in the exploration of the Earth, and that adventure, too, is now taking place on other moons and planets. The explorers today are not humans in spacesuits with geological hammers and notepads, but sophisticated spacecraft launched into outer space. Their cameras and sensors show strange and beautiful geological vistas of startling diversity. Much of the frozen surface of Mars is a landscape from 3 billion years ago, far older than any Earth landscape. Venus, by contrast, is continually being resurfaced by volcanic eruptions. Some of its lava flows, insulated by the oven-hot atmosphere, are thousands of kilometers long. Even this hellish planet, though, does not take the palm for volcanism. That award must go to Io, the moon of Jupiter, with continual eruptions, powered as it is squeezed and kneaded by the tidal forces generated by its massive parent planet. Farther out, Titan, the moon of Saturn, has hydrocarbon rivers and oceans on a water ice landscape, beneath which lies a deep water ocean. Even more distant, Pluto, now classed as a dwarf planet, revealed totally unexpected geological formations when the New Horizons spacecraft sped by in 2015. Patterned plains of nitrogen ice looking like gigantic quilts lap against rugged ice mountains, while parts of the land surface show a unique dragon scale pattern of high ridges and deep hollows. This diversity represents just the geology of our own solar system. As we begin to glimpse the planets of other star systems, including the rocky super-Earths now known to abound, we can only be sure that many more surprises lie ahead. The frontiers of geology, hence, extend in all directions and are nothing if not dramatic. But this science also lies much closer to home. It permeates our lives to the extent that we can be constantly surrounded by geology, yet barely notice it day to day. We live in houses that are made of the reconstituted and flash-metamorphosed mudstone that we call brick, and work in the giant sandcastles held together by lime and mud that we call our concrete buildings. The frameworks of our buildings and of our machines are mostly of iron and steel, almost all of which originated when our planet underwent a protracted chemical revolution between 2 and 3 billion years ago. Our machines also include huge amounts of iron, copper, lead, tin, zinc, aluminum, all of which we extract from ore deposits, often deep underground, while new technology now requires the geologist to prospect for ores of neodymium, gallium, europium, and a host of other less well-known elements, all of which occur in their own particular geological circumstances. Luckily, our planet includes a wealth of minerals that is almost certainly unrivaled in our solar system, and most of these minerals are essentially byproducts of the, so far as we know, unique planetary engineering that makes up plate tectonics. Our new urban empires constantly need vast amounts of energy to power them, and this comes from geology, in the shape of the oil and coal and gas that we still utterly rely upon. And, as is now all too clear, the burning of these hydrocarbons is changing the chemistry of atmosphere and oceans, and beginning to transform our climate into a new and, for us as for many other organisms, uncomfortable and dangerous state. Again, it is the geological analysis of the climate history of the Earth, of prehistoric episodes of ice ages and of global warming, that allows us to understand how our own species' experiment with this planet compares in scale and speed with past climate perturbations. Geology thus has enormous fascination as a science and huge importance for society, yet it is not as well known as it should be. To many people, the word can still conjure up impressions of rows of dull rock specimens in museum cabinets. Nonetheless, geology provokes great loyalty and affection in those who know it, with many amateur enthusiasts as well as those whose career it is. Professional geologists are usually enthusiasts, too, and many simply carry on doing geology for fun when they retire. Geology is a science that encompasses virtually all the other sciences, chemistry, physics, biology, geography, oceanography, and many others, and involves or impinges upon many of the humanities and arts. There are aspects that geologists adore, the field work, whether in the most exotic or prosaic of places, the polished rock slabs used for decoration in our city centers often show exquisite geological structures, the sense of discovery just around the corner, and the way in which lateral thinking and improvisation lie at the heart of its study. Not least also, there is the camaraderie among amateurs and professionals, and teachers and students within this science. This very short introduction represents a personal overview of a lifelong working geologist, and an enthusiast too, like virtually all my colleagues. It cannot hope to encompass the whole field, but I trust it will give some flavor of what geology is today. One way to begin to tell its story is through the discoveries that have built the science. The men and women who pioneered the science realized, as discovery followed discovery, just how ancient is the planet that we live on, and how dramatic its history. Chapter 2. Geology, the Early Days. Our early ancestors, likely puzzled in their freer moments, about what the Earth is made of and how it arose. The early history of this kind of questioning has been completely lost. It probably extended back many thousands of years before the beginning of recorded history. But among the written records of the early settled civilizations, such as those of the ancient Greeks, Romans, Indians, and Chinese, fragments of this intellectual adventure can be glimpsed. Early ideas. Among the earliest recorded speculations on the Earth that we might regard as broadly scientific were those of the ancient Greeks. Their curiosity about the workings of the Earth was just one part of a flowering of art, drama, and philosophy, and extended to many phenomena that we would now regard as geological. There was the shape and size of the whole Earth, for instance. Anaximander of Miletus, 611 to 547 BC, made perhaps the first map of the world, with the Mediterranean as the center of an earth that he saw as the circular top of a motionless cylinder. A century later, Pythagoras, 570 to 495 BC, suggested that the earth was spherical, a claim demonstrated by Aristotle, 384 to 322 BC, through an understanding of how solar eclipses worked. Eratosthenes, 275 to 195 BC, a Greek who became a librarian at Alexandria in Egypt, later calculated the circumference of that spherical earth to within 1% of the true value by geometry, using measurements of a shadow cast by the sun at noon at two places, the distance between which was known. Aristotle, a pupil of Plato, who in turn had been a pupil of Socrates, was a key figure whose influence was to last more than a millennium. While not a scientist in a modern sense, he used logic combined with general observations to generate hypotheses, explaining phenomena in terms of natural rather than supernatural causes, though with mixed results when viewed in the light of modern knowledge. His studies ranged widely, but included questions of what we now call geology. Earthquakes, he suggested, were due to the violent release of trapped winds within the earth, and fossils were the remains of once living, though rock-encased, he thought, creatures. He saw that rivers could dry up, and so surmised that seas could also disappear and change place with land. Aristotle's prestige was such that his views, which included the earth being at the center of the universe, overshadowed those of others, such as Anaximander and Democritus, 460 to 370 BC, who saw the earth as just one of many worlds. Aristotle's ideas continued to hold sway for many centuries and were even adopted as part of the philosophy of the Catholic Church. Arguably, this for long held back further scientific progress, which was ironic in view of Aristotle's championing of empirical deduction as a foundation to knowledge. Other cultures independently developed ideas of the earth and its processes. In India of the Vedic period, circa 1300 to 300 BC, texts such as the Puranas included ideas of cycles of creation and destruction on billion-year timescales. Later scholars such as the mathematician Aryabhata, 476 to 550 AD, realized that the rotation of the earth made the stars seem to move across the sky, correctly interpreted eclipses as shadows cast by the moon, and precisely predicted eclipses by calculation. In China, the Song Dynasty, 960 to 1279 AD, saw major scientific advances, facilitated and preserved by the discovery and development of printing. A remarkable polymath, Shen Kuo, 1032 to 1095, recognized the nature of fossils and worked out not only that they were once living organisms, but also deduced changed positions of land and sea from them, and changes of climate, too. Making observations of fossil bamboo in hilly ground where they did not grow, he suggested that formerly there had been wetter conditions in that region. Geology in enlightened times of the Western world. While such advances were being made in the East, the Western world was in the intellectual slowdown of the Dark and Middle Ages. As it was emerging from this, Leonardo da Vinci, 1452 to 1519, artist, engineer, inventor, musician, scientist, considered the workings of the earth. Like Shen Kuo before him, he recognized the true nature of fossils as the petrified remains of very ancient organisms. He saw that marine seashells were present on mountainsides above the sea. He saw that these fossils were encased within the rock strata at more than one level, rather than just scattered on the surface, and that some were in life position with the valves joined together. He deduced that they had been laid down on an ancient seafloor, which silted up and was raised high above sea level. These were very modern findings, though Leonardo used them to put together a view of the earth in medieval terms as a gigantic, dynamic macrocosm of the human body with a circulatory system in the form of rivers. The work was less influential at the time than it might have been because of the mirror writing code Leonardo used in his notebooks. A little after Leonardo's time, the word geology was first introduced by the Italian Ulisse Aldrovandi, 1522 to 1605, though the term, derived from the Greek words for earth and speech, was not to go into general circulation until the 19th century. Aldrovandi, who became professor of natural sciences at Bologna University, was regarded as the father of natural history by Georges-Louis Leclerc, Comte de Buffon, 1707 to 1788, a prominent figure of the European Enlightenment and one of the most brilliant savants of 18th century France. Indefatigably hard-working and an eloquent writer, Buffon made his reputation through a 36-volume natural history in which he mainly developed early ideas of biological science. Late in life, though, he wrote a short book, The Epochs of Nature, which has a claim to being the first scientific evidence-based geological history of the Earth. His published estimate of its age, based on the cooling rate of heated metal spheres, was 75,000 years, though privately he thought the Earth was millions of years old. In this history, he deduced a single-cycle Earth, which changed its geography, climate, and biology as it cooled from an original molten ball that, he suggested, had been torn from the sun by a passing comet. Although this and much else was disproved by later work, both the scale and detail of his planetary reconstruction were influential, while some of his deductions were inspired, such as working out that coal seams were the remains of buried, compressed tropical swamps. Working more or less at the same time as Buffon, James Hutton, 1726 to 1797, was a Scottish farmer and scientist who recognized and argued for the existence of deep time, that is, geological time, and demonstrated the great age of the Earth. In contrast to Buffon's finite, cooling-based estimate, he thought this to be an endless span, with no vestige of a beginning and no prospect of an end. Hutton based his ideas on evidence such as angular unconformities, where one series of strata cuts sharply across another. He recognized that this phenomenon must demand enormous amounts of time for the deposition and burial of sedimentary layers, then their deformation, uplift, and erosion, and then subsidence and renewed deposition, with the cycle repeated again to result in modern erosion. Hutton needed an energy source to drive this formidable Earth machine and found it in subterranean heat, recognizing the magmatic and intrusive nature of rocks such as granites that ascended and dragged adjacent rock strata with them. He was thus a Plutonist as opposed to the Neptunists of that time, such as the German scientist Abraham Gottlob Werner, 1749 to 1817, who thought that granites had crystallized from seawater. Assembling the evidence, Hutton envisaged the rock cycle, with strata being produced by erosion of the land, being buried, and in part metamorphosed or melted, and then uplifted again for the next cycle of erosion to take place. Further insights into the prehistoric Earth came with Baron Georges Cuvier, 1769 to 1832. During the French Revolution, Georges Cuvier, his background was working class rather than aristocratic, was a tutor in rural France. Fascinated by natural history from an early age, he became, after the Revolution, a member of the National Museum of Natural History in Paris and went on to become the world's foremost anatomist. Cuvier is perhaps best known for firmly establishing the fact of animal extinction, which Buffon had postulated, by showing clear anatomical differences between the extinct mammoth and the modern elephant. This is not as easy as it now sounds. People were aware of fossils such as trilobites and ammonites preserved within rock strata, but wondered whether such organisms might not be still living in the depths of the oceans, a place then essentially unexplored and unknown, and that occasionally yield living fossils, such as the pearly nautilus. The world was by then sufficiently well explored to show, with reasonable confidence, that a large land animal such as the mammoth could not still be alive anywhere on Earth. Cuvier is also associated with the idea today termed catastrophism, though he used the term revolutions, as the fossils of any region were different from the animals and plants that live there today. He proposed that the organisms that they represented had perished in a succession of revolutions affecting entire regions, but not, he thought, the whole Earth, to be replaced by animals and plants migrating in from unaffected regions. Cuvier did not believe in the idea of biological evolution then being developed, even before Darwin, by scientists such as Lamarck. Although he could show how species had become extinct, he was at a loss to say how they originated. Buffon, Hutton, and Cuvier were all, in their working lives, established and wealthy enough to follow their scientific interests. Some of the foundations of geology were built, though, by working people, who made their discoveries amid difficult personal circumstances. Mary Anning, 1799 to 1847, was born into an impoverished carpenter's family in Dorset. She became, through determination, skill, and courage, a key figure in the recognition that strange, long-vanished animals had lived in prehistoric time. She
excavated. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.